Before his conversion, life walking in the flesh, to life walking in the spirit, Paul grew to be a man of firm conviction and fiery temperament. He always acted on his beliefs. Thus, when he was confronted with what he took to be hearsay to Judaism, he worked with all his might to quell it. This hearsay, one day, came to be known as Christianity, and Paul was among the foremost of its persecutors. He then undertook a mission to Damascus. There he intended to continue attacking Christians. However, on the way, he had a vision. This vision is described several times in the Bible, three times in the book of Acts. Paul saw Jesus, who asked and why Paul persisted in persecuting him. He then commissioned Paul to preach his message to the Gentiles. This meeting with Jesus made Paul a Christian. He became the most skillful, zealous preacher fitted to win souls. Paul wrote a letter to all that are in Rome professing to be a Christian. Paul understood the privileges a Christian is given, and the duty of a Christian is to be holy. They are called to salvation through sanctification, that those that are called saints should labor to answer to the name. Otherwise, though it is an honor and a privilege, yet it will be of little avail at his great return to have been called a saint and not really be so. Rome was a city built upon a hill. Everyone took notice of what was done there. The Church of Rome was then a flourishing church that has now become dim. Paul came to bring them into the full knowledge of Christ and the benefits he brings. Today, saints, we look much like the Christians in Rome. We lack knowledge and truth about what is required of a Christian and how to walk and live in the victory of his coverage. We are living a defeated life, giving the devil so much power because we are powerless. We don't believe in our own prayers because we have no faith. We have no peace because we lean to our own understanding and God can't comfort us. We have no joy because we worry about tomorrow, when God said, let tomorrow take care of itself. We refuse to walk in victory, live free of the cares of this world on earth. Are you covered? Has God restored you back to his original plan for us? Three key points to aid us in living out our walk with Christ fully covered. One, we need to acknowledge that we need him. We must activate his spirit within us. And three, we want to access him through his word and our obedience. Acknowledge. We, the believer, must understand that the power of sin is so great that no individual on earth, even the strongest Christian, can overcome this monster of sin within his own strength and ability. That is why Jesus went to the cross. Is there anybody glad that Jesus went to the cross? We must accept and stand up and acknowledge that we are a sinner and ask God to save us. We must recognize our inability to live without him. We must acknowledge that we need Jesus to cover us. We now are united by faith with him in his resurrection life. We now have unbroken fellowship with God and freedom from sin. The only way to overcome sin is by the power of the Holy Spirit. Although every believer has the Holy Spirit, the work of the Holy Spirit within our hearts and lives is not automatic. The Spirit of God demands that we have faith in the cross of Christ. Activate. How do we allow the Holy Spirit to be activated in our lives? The Holy Spirit is a vehicle by which the Spirit of life in Christ works. It guarantees all that life that comes from Christ as a result of the cross is made free from the law of sin and death. The reason the Christian is in trouble in the first place is because he doesn't understand how the Spirit works. We need the Spirit's help, and we need it greatly. However, if we evidence faith in anything other than the cross of Christ as it regards to our victory, our freedom from sin, The Holy Spirit simply cannot help us. This is the law. We must not put our faith in ourselves, man, or anything but Jesus. If we function within this law, the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus, which refers to what Christ did on the cross must ever be the object of our faith. Then we walk in victory. What Christ did at the cross makes it possible for us to live victorious. Man under his own willpower couldn't keep the law, so God sent a Savior, Jesus. Now we are to have faith in the law of the Spirit of life through Christ Jesus. A Christian's ability outside of the Holy Spirit is to walk in the law of the flesh. If we walk out, live life by trusting in our own strength, flesh, we will fail every time. Walking after the flesh is trusting in anything other than the cross of Christ. Walking after the Spirit is placing our faith and our trust in the cross of Christ. If a Christian fails to keep his faith in the cross, it requires restoration. We are saved by faith. We are kept by faith in the cross exclusively. Now, how do we access him? Many of us have done everything it takes to access the desires of our heart, but not our God. God is the only one we desire and do none of the work. When we get a new job, we get a handbook that tells us what is expected of us. When we sign up for school, we find out what we have to do to gain our degree. We have read and purchased the material. We have to read and purchase the materials if we desire to pass the test. Only when we get saved, we aren't finding out what it will take, how much time we must spend reading the Bible for ourselves in order to pass the test. No man can show us and tell us about our God like the Word of God. We must take the time to find out what being a Christian requires and what benefits it brings. To obey from the heart means to give yourself fully to God. To love him with all thy heart and with all thy soul and with all thy mind. Matthew 22:37. And yet so often, our efforts to know and obey God's commandments can best be described as half-hearted. A Christian is not someone who cannot sin, but someone who is no longer a slave to sin. He belongs to God. You are free to choose between two masters, but you are not free to adjust the consequences of your choice. The currency of sin is death. Christ's currency is eternal life, a new life with God that begins on earth and continues forever with God. What choice have you made? Are you covered? Our issues come out of our heart. It is not life doing it to us. We do it to ourselves. What is in us controls what's around us and what will come out of us. Mold your heart with the Word, not the world. If we put the right things in our hearts, the right things will come out. Bad thoughts equal bad heart. God knows your heart, but when can he know you based on your actions? Whatever we have our mind set on, that is what we will do. Strongholds exist in our minds. Strongholds resist the Word of God and hold on to prior knowledge. It is the Word that drives us to change, not the church. Romans 8:6 says, "For to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace." Romans 8:8 says, "So then they that are in the flesh cannot please God." Verse 9 clearly states, "Now if any man have not the Spirit of Christ, he is none of his." He does not belong to Christ. He is not truly a child of God. Romans 8:14 says, "For as many are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God." Ephesians 4:23-24 says, "And be renewed in the spirit of your mind, having a fresh and mental spiritual attitude, and that ye put on the new man, which after God is created in righteousness and true holiness." God's image, become God-like. We must renew our minds. because we will do what we are used to. Our old habits will control us. We have to make new habits by doing the same holy things over and over until we do it subconsciously. We are part of this world.